El próximo ponente de este bloque es el doctor Frank Molina. El doctor Frank Molina es presidente del clúster Eurobiomed, un clúster que abarca todo el sur de Francia y que trabaja sobre todo en la parte médica. Para darles algunos números, Eurobiomed hoy día son 10.000 investigadores en el sector médico. Son en este momento 200 proyectos que están financiados a la altura de 1.300 millones de pesos. El doctor Frank Molina también es director de una unidad mixta donde está la investigación pública con el CNRS de Francia y con la empresa Bio-Rad. Ellos son líderes en la parte de diagnóstico médico. Es uno de los pocos equipos en el mundo que trabajan sobre este tema. El doctor ha publicado más de 100 publicaciones en revistas internacionales y también es presidente del clúster europeo Alliance Diagnostic. Entonces, les pido por favor un fuerte aplauso para el doctor Frank Molina.
Muchas gracias, Erwan. En primer lugar, quiero decir que soy muy honoroso de estar aquí y muchas gracias a los organizadores de invitarme aquí, que me encanta primero de hablar español, muy mal, pero para mí es un enorme, y de estar aquí al frente de esta comunidad muy activa e impresionante con sus resultados. Entonces, me agradece de estar aquí y muchas gracias de invitarme. Muchas gracias también a Erwan, que está un organizador increíble con dinámica nuclear. Muchas gracias, Erwan. Pero se puede ver que mi español está muy malo. Entonces, pues, voy a continuar con inglés. Disculpe por ese. Oh. Lo que fue en México, City, un lunes, recordando de mi español, es terrible para hablar profesional. Bueno, puedo probar al final, si me siento. Vamos. Ok, empezamos a las cosas seriosas. Ok, como Erwan lo dice, este clúster Eurobiomed está en el sur de Francia. Se puede ver, ¿dónde está el? Sí, no, no estaba este. No hay un. Bueno, dos. Ok. Ok. So the cluster is the south of France. It's covering the two regions, Région PACA and Région Languedoc-Roussillon. It's covering basically all the border from the Mediterranean Sea. And there is the highest density in biotechnology laboratories and companies, especially in the topic of medical diagnosis, because there is a very long and famous history in medical universities. There is the first medical university in the world from the 11th century there, and there is a long tradition. So that's why in medical industry, biotechnology and research, there is a very high density in this region. And so Eurobiomed is a cluster. It's a cluster joining forces from academic research, industrial research, but as well clinical research. And three of them are very important for medical development. So, as everyone was saying, that's around 40 companies, 10,000 people, a lot of projects going all the directions. It's really exciting to work there. But what the cluster is doing there? Basically, a couple of years ago, people were working as a self-sufficient, but they realized that it was very difficult to become very competitive by doing that by yourself. All the small companies, all the small laboratories, the big as well laboratories, and the big companies know that right now all over the world, including the multinational company, that they cannot do big projects and being competitive by themselves alone. So everywhere in the world, this concept of cluster emerge here as well, and it emerged for doing what? All the research centers, private or public, are able to do their own research. But the connectivities in between themselves are very difficult to do. And so the cluster can help by networking, help them to do the interface in between all these worlds. and by supporting as well the project which need this kind of help for doing something new in between the different culture from public, academic, and clinics. And so the Eurobiomed is doing that and covering different kind of topics. There is a list here. Especially one of the biggest topics in terms of strategy is the one for medical diagnosis because of what I was saying, the density of the company. So this subgroup and these sectors is called Euromedag inside Eurobiomed and covering medical diagnosis. Eurobiomed clusters is doing different things for companies. It's not doing research by itself. Research are the actors, but the actors need some help for networking. Networking first within themselves, because not everybody is knowing each other, even on the same site. That's probably the case here, like it is the case everywhere in the world. But as well, networking with other groups, other clusters. And that's why I'm here today. It's because we need to create networks, not only in between themselves, but with other people, exchange culture, exchange protocols, exchange experiments, exchange forces, and gather forces to do even more ambitious projects. So the cluster is helping for that. As well, it's doing a transnational project support. So like here, we are planning to have some international project support, creating some new partnerships, which usually are difficult to create. And as well, the final objective is not of doing nice research. The final objective is to provide a good research, which provides transformation in something which could make the companies growing out of that. Because behind the companies, there is a growing economy, and behind this growing economy, there are two things, especially in medical diagnosis. There is one thing, which is the growing of the well-being in your own country, employment and so on, but as well for the patient, there is a growing and of the quality of the treatment he's going to receive. And both of them, at the end up with a better social functioning. So it's very important. Each of us here have a role in all this chain in order to provide a well-being at the end. It's not only doing research, doing publication, doing patent, doing money. It has it as well, at the end, having a better patient benefit. So the project in Eurobiomed, then the market access is important for that. But the project in Eurobiomed, them are selected, so everybody is sending project. Eurobiomed is selecting the project, labeling project, and then help people which have project to create a project which seems feasible, ambitious, but possible to do. And then we send that to grant authorities, and the success of this kind of things, this kind of grant call, is much higher because the clusters is helping on behind. And then here in our cluster, we have more than 120 projects which have been granted, which make at the end a lot of money within research, and at the end, a lot of people, new people employed on this research. Something like 600 last year employment just for research thanks to these new grants, and something like 150 people just for indirect employment. So this is very important, and not only in terms of research and innovation. So in Eurobiomed, we have this strategy to not only doing everything on with everybody. We decided to have strategic axes which want to concentrate our forces. And so medical diagnosis is one of the most strategic and biggest one, but there are others. There are others. I will maybe tell a word at the end about that. Especially for us, we are concentrated in diagnostic. Why? Because medical diagnostic world changed completely. It used to be a sort of artisanal sector a couple of years ago where the business was very small, the research was very small, everybody was concentrated on treatment. But a couple of years ago, people realized by doing big studies all over the world and all over the system of Earth, they realized that less than 5% of hospital cost and about less than 2% of the health cost in general were devoted to medical diagnosis. It's very low. But medical diagnosis influences up to 7% the medical decision. So the cost for a good medical decision is very low. And in meanwhile, the pharmaceutical business is decreasing because probably you know that it is very difficult to find new kind of drugs, very long. So today, there is a huge growing of this market because of the benefit for the patient by identifying as soon as possible the risk of a pathology, an eventual pathology starting, and the following of a pathology which is under treatment. But knowing very much in advance that a pathology is starting or is going to start, or it is at risk to start, it's very important and help very much the quality of the treatment and the chance of success later on. So that's why a lot of people now in research and in industry in medical diagnosis, and that's why now the market is growing. Especially now, there is a new paradigm. The new paradigm of the convergence in between pharma, drug, treatments, and medical diagnosis. Because people want to do personalized medicine, having a better treatment, not a treatment for everybody, a treatment which is adapted for each of us. To adapt a treatment to somebody in particular, you need to assay these people, measure its own parameters, its capacity to respond to a drug better than another. For that, you use the tool of medical diagnosis. Then, this is something which is increasing the market of medical diagnosis, because before it was only to detect a pathology, but now it's not only to detect a pathology, it's as well to detect the capacity to respond to a drug. As well, for that, we need biomarkers. Biomarkers is a key notion. I will go back to that in a minute. Biomarkers are molecules that you want to follow to have information on the patients. But the biomarker are various kind of biomarker, proteins, genes, mutations, metabolites, and so on, and is evolving. But it's a central concept in medical diagnosis. And as well, now the practices are changing. Now, instead of doing only diagnosis with the hospital or with an indication of a doctor, now we want to do the diagnosis close to the patient, close to the bed of the patient. And in the future, people want to do diagnostic that the patient is doing by itself, by himself. So this is so-called POC, point of care, close to the patient, or home monitoring. And for doing that, we need to put a new technology inside the medical diagnosis, usually a technology which is more on the side of biotechnology. Now, communication technology, informatics, computing, electronics are coming very strongly into the field. And a lot of people now are mixing these approaches for doing miniaturized devices for using that close to the patient. And so obviously, the interface in between liquid biology and electronics are not that easy, but it's a strong field today in medical diagnosis. So there is room for a lot of different people there, and not only biologists. So basically, and I will end up with numbers with that and go back a bit more about technologies, but IVD means in vitro diagnosis, so it's the biggest part of medical diagnosis, represents a big market which is increasing, that was saying just before, and Europe and state basically are the biggest market all over the world. And in Europe especially, the three biggest markets are Germany, France and Italy. Because of the health systems, which is very generous and is paying quite a lot for medical diagnosis. Medical diagnosis in France, for instance, 20% of the costs are only devoted for glycemic survey, which is a lot. And for the practitioner who is doing medical diagnosis for the moment, that's specialized laboratories for analysis, for half of it, and another almost half are the hospital diagnostic center. Very few of them are done by the patients themselves. This is going to change soon. So now we want to do some innovation to adapt to this transformation of the market. And the problem we have, and it's a chance as well, it's doing innovation in medical diagnosis, basically it's combining a lot of culture, scientific culture, medical culture, and business culture. If we want to run the story from the beginning to the end, we have to go to all through that, and not only doing our research, doing a publication, because the publication will not be used by the patient as a medical diagnosis. Somebody must do a medical device and diagnosis that will be useful in the hospital in a professional manner. So we need to do innovation in science. We cannot afford not doing science and doing that. And at the very beginning of the project, that's a scientist which got the lead on that. And they create innovative solutions, they do research, they do validations, they create new technology. And it's very interdisciplinary already. But all these scientists there are here to increase the possibilities, to increase the capacities of innovation. But then came the clinicians, which talk with the scientists and would say, oh, your ideas is great. That's going to change the life of everybody. The problem is I cannot do it. Your machine is bigger than my building. That's just an example. Your machine is much higher in terms of cost than the cost of the old hospital for a year. So there are things you can do, scientifically speaking, but that things you cannot use on a clinical basis, on a day basis, in between the patient and the medical doctor. So they are reducing the possibilities to something which is feasible in reality. And behind came, let's imagine your project succeeds, it's gone. The clinician and the scientist find a way to work together in something realistic in terms of clinical practice. Then came the business guys, which say, well, we're going to transform that into a real project. We're going to do validations all over the world. We are going to qualify, to verify everything, and then send a product to the hospital, and the patient will benefit out of that. But the problem is your innovation is not affordable for a company like me. So you have to have an innovation which, from the very beginning, think about not only science, not only practice in terms of clinics, but as well it's something feasible in terms of production, transformation, and marketing. Marketing in terms of going to the market, not communicating, right? So all of them, they are the business hours, well, reducing all these possibilities opened by the scientist. And by making all these people working together from the very beginning, change completely the life, because the project then got a very high chance to go up to the end if the process goes on. So for doing these people working together, it's not easy. They are in different place very often. They don't speak the same language. Maybe you experienced that already. But we need to do that. And so the new models, you perfectly know that, it's to perform translational medicine from basic research, clinics, and industrial transfer. And for doing that, you need to have people in the same place, talking the same language, having and sharing the culture. So that's why 10 years ago we created this new kind of institution for doing research and innovation, which is called CISDIAG. So CISDIAG is a joint center for research in between CNRS, which is a center for research in France, which is academical, and Bio-Rad, which is an international company well known for its machine technologies, but as well is one of the leading companies for medical diagnostics in the world. And so we join our forces for two things. First, understand the pathology, understand the molecular mechanisms. It's more on the side on the fundamental research. But out of that, identify biomarkers and transformed and created probes to measure these biomarkers and create technology to measure this biomarker to something we can transfer to an application usable by clinician. You see all the landscape like that. And so that means in this kind of laboratories, half of the person are academical researcher, and half of the person an industrial researcher, and all the projects are done with clinical partners. For doing that as well, I was talking about interdisciplinary is needed now. The complexity of the biology is very high. We saw nice talks about everything that was thought before, and the paradigm is changing for antibiotics, for genomics, for production of mass of energy, for instance. I saw very interesting things. So everything is complex. You need models. You need experiment. And for doing that, you need mathematicians. You need computing people, right close to the biologist. And they need to talk to each other with a common language. So now in a lab, for instance, we got 70% of people at the bench, experimentalists, 30% which are mathematicians and modeling people. So the way we are working, it's basically projects which are here. I don't know if I catch up. Okay. We got the project going that way. We got the discipline which goes through the project. And so there is no team of discipline within our lab. We got platforms. and we produce publication, patent, and industrial transfer. But the most important one is to have clinicians with us working for all of this project. So the classical procedure for developing an innovation in medical diagnostic is starting for clinical questions, catching good clinical samples. It's very difficult to find good clinical samples. They are all human. There are a lot of regulatory issues out of that. It's very difficult to have this sample in shape. So for us, it's highly important. Then we do experiment, biomarker identification. Then we do mathematics, signal analysis, statistics. And then we do modeling to try to understand how it works in between the networks in a cell, for instance. When we are happy with a set of biomarkers, then we have to measure them. So we need to design probes like antibodies, like oligonucleotides if it's genetics and so on, and use a technology to measure them. So this is not the end of the story. Behind that, let's imagine everything works. You have to go to clinical validations, so new other samples in big numbers to verify that what you say is relevant for a wide population. And then you have to do the diagnostic assay development, the technology, and go through regulatory issue. So the story and the path is long, but just here, that's an example. You can use proteomics for doing biomarker identification, transcriptomic, and so on. Doesn't matter, but the path is always the same. Recently, we tried to complexify a bit the landscape because we realized that doing just proteomics or transcriptomic or metabolomic is not enough. We have the nature is not only that. The nature is complex. All these parameters are moving together. So we try to integrate all these parameters using experiment here, but as well mathematics to integrate the information, try to do some mathematical modeling to try to understand the dynamic of what is happening in the system, and refine our view on the set of biomarkers, which is interesting for us. And then we carry on by designing, for instance, antibody and assays that which can go later on the machine with a format, assay format compatible with machine existing already in the hospital. So there are various axes to develop for doing diagnosis. As usual, we can do medical diagnosis to know as soon as possible if there is a disease, if somebody has got a disease. But as well, I was talking about point-of-care technology of theranostic. Theranostic means trying to know if the drug is going to be active or not. Doing that means having different kind of strategy in terms of technology and projects running. But everything, in terms of theranostics, everything is combined when you look at the procedure. If you see here at the, on the slide down, then you see that for pharmaceutical development of a project, you look at the target identification, then you try to identify a compound, then you go through clinical studies. For diagnostic, it's almost the same, but instead of looking for a target, you look at biomarkers. And instead of trying to act on the activity of the molecule, you try to measure it in a very precise way. But at the end, now there is a convergence for both of them for doing theranostic and using the information from the diagnostic to drug efficacy. But for that, we need biomarkers. And biomarkers are just signing the functioning of pathways and cells. So there can be different kind of parameters. Usually there are molecules, they are the most widely used. But not only, it could be a questionnaire, it could be physical parameters, an electrocardiogram, for instance, et cetera, et cetera. But the thing is, a good biomarker is something which is an objective measurement. It's a term coming from physics. Objective means with numbers demonstrable, with a demonstration behind. So that means numbers you can rely on and reproducible. And they can act as an indicator. And then they can be used for different kind of things like predictive biomarker before the disease arrived, so diagnostic biomarker for looking at the disease, and even biomarker to follow the disease, for instance. The problem is, there are many biomarkers. And the medical doctor is in front of a problem. He has to take a decision. And this decision should integrate what he knows from all these biomarkers. So at the end, he's quite happy to have some help from algorithm to try to have some new algorithm which help the decision of the medicine doctors. And so then come in, into the game the actors from computing science, which can provide new kind of algorithm taking into account the variability of the biology and helping the doctors in taking decision. But if we look at biomarker, the problem is the dimensionalities. Dimensionalities from small molecules, metabolites, then proteins, genomes. They're all different kind of proteins with different kind of function networks. Not that simple that only gene proteins, RNA proteins, and metabolites. It's much more complicated than that, and they are interacting between themselves. In addition, dynamic range into the blood of this molecule, which is very big. So meaning that when you look at different biomarker, and this is always the case because there is no one biomarker for disease, then it could happen, here this is a kind of quantities you find for different biomarkers in the blood, and you see that there are biomarkers with high quantity into the blood and others with low quantity. Just imagine you need to measure at one time, meanwhile, two biomarkers, one very low amount, the other small amount, then you come into technical problem with your technologies and which are problems of dynamic range for measurement. And some signal can be hidden by other signal within a complex medium. So there are a lot of technical issues behind that, and not only classical biological pathways issue. In addition, there is a high variability for the contents for liquid, for instance, coming and the samples coming from humans. And so this variability should be addressed, especially by doing large set of experiments, so meaning large set of samples. And there is no way to have a result which got a sense in medicine and in diagnostic with only 10 samples. Let's say, classically speaking, 10 replicate. 10 replicate is nothing. Starting for something, we should be 50, 100 minimum. So this is something to take into account when you run a new project. And obviously, there are needs and there are different kinds of biomarkers. But sometimes, there are some biomarkers, when you are lucky, which can do almost all of them. But there are very few, they are right in the middle. Otherwise, you get the biomarkers which are specific for a given indication, a given questions, and you have to identify when you look at your biomarker what question is addressing my biomarker, and not, I got the biomarker of diabetes, which means nothing. And as well, a new concept of biomarker, sentinel biomarker, is emerging, which means that some biomarker will be some sentinel, like the temperature is a sentinel of there is something going on with the patient. So this is such a kind of biomarker which always move in terms of quantities and numbers when something happened. Doesn't matter if you don't know, but just imagine you got a biomarker which say, oh, there is a cancer there. Doesn't matter the cancer, what the cancer is. There is a cancer there. Then immediately you can specify with different kind of analysis. And this is very interesting to have such a kind of sentinel biomarker, very general, because like that, in the future, we can envision kind of diagnostic that we are going today to do on a day basis at home without even knowing it, with devices which is doing that on a day basis and which are looking for sentinel biomarkers and not only the temperature. And when something is going, then it's going to give a warning to your medicine doctors, and the medicine doctor is going to send you to have an analyze for specific biomarkers. So that's a new emerging concept for biomarkers. But still the problem of the complexity. And now we are going to talk a bit about technology. Complexity cannot be addressed by one person or one team just like that, by doing experiment. We need to integrate that into models. That's why we need computing and mathematics. And there are some technology for doing that, so-called systems biology. And system biology basically is using a run of experiment, a turn of experiment, modeling and design. But system biology is there to combine experiment and modeling by, in order to try to understand the system. So you try to integrate all the information, molecular information of the systems, you try to measure them, genomic, metabolomic, proteomics, and you look at them, you integrate them in a model, and you try to understand what the phenotype of the model, the study, the cell, for instance. If you use that kind of technology in another way around, then you can do another thing. You can even use experiment and modeling to design new biological systems, new cells, artificial cells, in order to create new kind of devices, which are biological tools, in order to do new kind of diagnostic. I will say a few words at the end. So let's talk about system biology, why it's so important for us in medical science. It's because, as I was saying, there are a lot of data accumulated at the molecular level, and we try to integrate that to understand how the cells are working, and how the group of cells into the tissue are working between themselves, and how they are organizing within organs, and then how the organs are sharing information and sharing molecules between themselves. So to integrate that, there is no way to do that by yourself. There are so many information and dynamic behind that, that you need a model, and you need mathematicians for doing that. The problem will be there, how to understand my system, how to cross the scale from molecules to cell and organ. And it is complicated, because by doing that, the very first we did this experiment realized that it was not simple as it was in the book in biology. So recently, the system biology now got something like 15 years old approaches, start in 1999, if I remember, with Kitano in Tokyo. And then many people now are doing that. It's a combination of a lot of technology and modeling approaches, and it's complex. It requires a lot of different lab and team. So you cannot afford that by just doing your experiment. We need to integrate all that, and it's costly, and so there are projects. But what show the result already existing? It shows that it's even more complicated than we thought. Here you see this moving picture. It's just the central carbon metabolism from a very well-known bacteria, which is Bacillus subtilis. And this is just when you change the food within a flask from glucose to malate. And then there is a cycle of expression of all the gene. And if you do a snapshot of the already existing enzyme at one time, there is no all the network. And if you do another snapshot at the time, later on, then you see that the snapshots are different. And you see here the expression of the enzyme of the cycle during the time when you change the food from glucose to malate. So a simple change in food within the flask for one simple bacteria well known changes completely the understanding of the network. And the most interesting thing, if you go, you start with malate and you add some glucose, you don't have the same change. It's not reversible. It's not at all the same picture. So that means the adaptation of any kind of living system is very high. So it shows us that we need to still learn a lot of things on that. And we are a biological systems, and in medicine, how can we use systems biology? First, integrating complex data. But Harris was a bit saying this morning, the biology understanding is changing. And now we realize, to make the story short, that measuring proteomics, genomics, etc., is not enough anymore. We need to look as well at the microbiome inside of ourselves, which is influencing not only the food uptake, but as well, it is influencing the gene expression of our own cell, which some of our own cells can be put under control from the bacteria from our own body, which are 10 times more than ourselves. And so taking into account not only our genetics, but the genetics and the proteomics of the microbiome we have inside is greatly, and it was demonstrating, helping to try to identify emerging disease within a patient. And where does come from the microbiome, for instance, from the intestine? This microbiome is coming from the food. And so here we see crossing areas which has used to be separated, like in between food productions, food qualifications, microbiome, and interaction within microbiomes and human, and influence of this microbiome on disease. So tomorrow, if we want to be predictive on this such a kind of systems, it's not enough to look only at the patient, but as well to look at the microbiome of the patient and its interaction with the. And so, looking at that now, everybody, this is a pattern extract from a company. The company which tried to develop new drugs or new diagnostic now have a much more complex pattern for discoveries. And so what they are doing, they do still experiment, various kind of experiment, that's the basic, integrating again through networks, and they use that to generate artificially hypotheses, and then there will be some experiments to validate the hypotheses, and in turn, with iterative testing, they are going to raise new hypotheses, refine the informations, and raising more precise hypotheses, and finally end up with a validation of a conclusion. And so that's a new pathway that people are using right now. And but still, as I was saying, metagenomic is a problem. It was demonstrating here a couple of publications, but there are much more than that in literature. It was demonstrating that gut microbiome influence diabetes, obesity, cardiovascular disease, colon cancer, Crohn disease, neurological disease. Now it's demonstrated. Even some mechanisms are known now. Even resistance to some drugs. And it was demonstrating as well that people which was living from different places in the world were sharing the risk of having a disease. Well, this is strange. Even if they were having different genetics. So having different genetics in one location in the world, living there, doesn't matter that much. It matters more that the people are living in the same place and they are sharing the same risk for the disease. Why is that? And basically because they are sharing the food, they are sharing the microbiome around the food, and if you look at the microbiome in between these people in different places of the world, there is a better correlation in between the microbiome profile and the risk for a disease than the correlation between the genetics and the risk for the disease. This is a very important information which changed completely the view on the clinics. And more recently, with some English friends, we realized that it was more amazing. A lot of information found in literature can demonstrate that our brain can be under control from the bacteria with molecules that are produced by the bacteria, which are already identified with mechanisms well known, and which put under control the brain in order to direct its capacity to have appetite to choose the food. So who is deciding now? Are we deciding what we are eating? Or are they our bacteria which are deciding for us what they need and ask us, basically, to look at food? So the question is open, and I can tell you that today, to date, nobody can really decide who is what and who is deciding what. This is a publication in the Journal of Bacteriology. But the consequence in the real life is that we are going to change our practice in clinics. So now we cannot anymore validating a kit or a treatment on a set of patients which are in the north of France and using them on patients which are in the south of Mexico. Because the validation need to take into account not only the patient and the genetics, but taking the location of the patient and its microbiome as well. So it is going to change completely the practice and the way the things are going to be done and the regulations are going to change probably. And then there are a lot of other consequences in biomarker discovery and the way we are going to look at biomarker. For sure in the future we are not going to look only at human biomarkers, but as well as human biomarkers combined with environmental biomarkers. And so here we see that if we want to address that, then we need to go through what is done already, influenced by the microbiome, so all the experiments done existing already, integrating them with so system biology, and then being able to work on optimized nutrition, new therapies, and obviously test assay for efficacy. And taking into account not only molecular aspects, but as well networks, social networks, geographics, information, and so on. So the picture is much more complex right now. But in the field of medical diagnostic now, new questions in the future are going to be raised. So are we going to still work on big machines, running a lot of samples in big hospital, or people are they going to do their own testing at home? Probably in the future, both are going to exist, but with a great increase in individual testing, with low cost, compared to large testing, high-speed, big machine with high cost and big precision. So a low-precision testing will be interesting. But for that, we need new machines, new device, close to the patient. And for that, electronics is very useful to combine experimental biology, liquid biology to electronics, and at the end to provide system to test glucose into the blood or other things. But for that, that's the reality today. A lot of laboratories now into the world are working for the new generation one. Instead of only working on the interface in between bioelectronics and biology, people are working, including ourselves, on trying to design new artificial systems which do logic like an electronical system. And so that means creating artificial biological system programmed as a computer to do specific tasks with algorithm and able to go where a computer cannot go or a robot cannot go. So how providing that? Then the principle is engineering principle, like we do systems from compound, subsystems, computers, up to networks of computers. In biology, you got compounds, you got cells, you got tissues, and you got organisms. So you can use such a kind of things. So I'm not going to detail. Obviously, there is a big part of modeling, a big part of predicting science, and a big part of experimental science and technology. But just here an example. We are working at designing a liposome, like an artificial cell, in which we put all the compound ourselves, like protein networks, enzyme networks, at the surface bio-captor, like a classical receptor, for the biomarker of interest. Then when the biomarker are in a medium, let's say plasma or urine, if they are there, there is an algorithm made by a biological networks, artificial one, we design it, which say when this marker is there, this one is not there, this one is increasing, then there is a risk of a disease. And then it colors the urine, for instance, in blue. And if when the urine is blue, so the patient can say, ah, my urine is blue. Or even the toilets can be provided and devices with a kit for detection of the blue and send the Wi-Fi information through the web to the medicine doctor. So that's the kind of things which is going to happen sometimes. And the patient is not doing anything else. The patient is just at home doing the classical life. So that means there are new changing in the model for competitiveness. I will finish on that. There are new clinical practice, new technology coming into the field. It's highly interdisciplinary. The interoperability in between the discipline is a key factor, and it's a human factor. So people are very important there. And we need a high capacity to develop collaborative and complex projects. So that's why the clusters are so important, and for doing open innovation. I like the word of competition. All the actors are in competition, but there are some projects that we cannot do by ourselves, and we need to do them as a group. And so that's why we create the group for medical diagnosis, which at the beginning was very small, and very quickly, because of the dynamic of the company which was there to put the energy, then we became the highest density cluster in terms of medical diagnosis. And because of that, we were the first in Europe. Because of that, Europe asked us to take the leadership in Europe and to create the European Agency for Medical Diagnosis, which now gather more than 10 clusters like Oxford, Berlin, Brussels, our clusters, Barcelona, Uppsala, Poland, etc., which gather their forces. It's up now to 400 companies in this. Gather their forces for doing projects ambitious that they cannot do together. They are concurrent, but there are some things they cannot do alone, and concurrent are working together on specific things, not on everything, on specific things, for creating new things they couldn't do before. And so obviously there, they need not even their own force. Now we realize that we need forces abroad, and so that's why we are here, to try to find contact, try to find interaction, and if we can, having some joint force to create even more ambitious projects. And so we are looking for partnerships, especially here in Mexico. Puedo cambiar por español. Ahora, es terminado. Y me encanta de ver tan energía y capacidad aquí. Habemos visto aquí por tres días que fuimos aquí, pero en los laboratorios académicos, en nuestra empresa estaba enorme. Y además hay una oportunidad increíble porque las personas que soportan, que decidan, el gobernador, ayer lo vimos, el gobierno de Francia también, quieren ayudar y no preguntan a nosotros, ¿qué hay que hacer? Pienso que podemos dar una respuesta, pero esta respuesta tenía que estar muy seriosa, porque si vamos a decir, podemos hacer muchas cosas, vamos a hacer todo, y al final en un año nos vemos juntos, muy agradable, pero nos vemos juntos y nada ocurre, no voy a regresar aquí, van a matarme. En Francia también, entonces me voy a ir a otro lugar. Entonces tenemos que encontrar proyectos que nos gustan, con motivación, pero además un proyecto, como le digo, que puede ir hasta el final. Es importante no solamente de haber un proyecto que está agradable, pero un proyecto para mí que se va al final, es el más agradable que puede ocurrir, porque al final es un reconocimiento, no sé, ¿cómo se dice? Reconocimiento, ¿está? Reconocimiento enorme, y espero que vamos a hacer este junto. So, muchas gracias por su atención. Aquí son las personas que nos ayudan para trabajar. Y gracias. Y aquí son los contactos para científicas, contactos y por todas. Si no hay respuesta a su email, mandar un email a Jennifer y se va a ayudar, porque se va a llamarme, hay que mandar una respuesta. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias, Frank, por esa presentación tan interesante. Un pequeño presente de parte de la universidad y del Biocluster. El siguiente ponente va a ser Sadot Arceniaga del CIDESI. Yo sé que has estado en el CIDESI ayer y dentro de esos proyectos que buscas que vayan hasta el final, ¿ves oportunidades con esos laboratorios?
Sí, es increíble, hay muchas oportunidades, pero CIDESI hace cosas que no necesita alguien porque hacen todo casi. Pero hablamos mucho ayer y estaba enorme porque hay otras posibilidades. Hacen ahora cosas que son de un nivel muy alto como internacional, porque he visto muchas otras cosas y hasta el mismo nivel. Pero juntos tenemos que hacer otras cosas, probablemente con una capacidad de hacer nuevas cosas que nadie puede hacer solo. Entonces, hay otras oportunidades también. Vamos a hablar mucho, pienso, en los meses que vienen.
Ok, muchas gracias, Juan.